Well, good morning and welcome to worship. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be His kingdom now and forever. As we come to worship, let us worship together as a resurrected community of believers and those who have embraced and live constantly into the gospel of forgiveness through our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us lift up our hearts and voices this morning.
Blessed be your name. In the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be, blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering, though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, turn back to when the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away, you give and take away. My heart will choose to say,
reading from Psalm 29, verse 1 and 2, and 10 and 11. Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of His holiness. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as King forever. The Lord gives strength to His people. The Lord blesses His people with peace.
The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh,
He is holy and he is righteous. And he is calling us ever to him by faith. And so, with confidence in our resurrected Lord as our Savior, let us come before him now and confess our sins. Must we see you in order to believe you, Lord? Is seeing truly believing? Are we to be prisoners of our senses, distrusting and rejecting whatever we cannot see, touch, or hear? Yet you are faithful. You give sight to the blind. You carry us when we are weary. You call us to your side. The locked room of our hearts opens at the turn of your key. Speak your words of life to us again. Do not doubt, only believe. Speak your words of life that we might live. Receive God's forgiveness, brothers and sisters, and the promise of the Spirit that is given to us, for Jesus is risen from the dead. Seen or unseen, he is present in our midst, and we see his presence in the faces of one another, the brothers and sisters, every time we joyfully gaze upon each other's faces. Happy are those who have not seen yet believe. Brothers and sisters, know that our sins are forgiven, and we are called by him evermore unto eternity with him, forgiven and redeemed.
By sinful men, torn and
Brothers and sisters, what do you believe? We believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Well, good morning, TCC kiddos. It is the fourth Sunday of the month, and that means that it is time for us to say these verses together for the very last time, at least together. Ephesians 4:32. So, Pastor Mark is going to say it first, just to jog your memory, and then you're going to say it by yourself. And then I'm going to tell you something really special, something really cool. Okay, listen to Pastor Mark first. Ephesians 4:32. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Ephesians 4:32. Okay, that's it right there. Pastor Mark has said it. Now, everyone, please stand up. Come closer to the TV. Come closer, closer. Okay, that's it. That's it. That's good. That's good. Now, I want you to say it by yourself on three. One, two, three. Ephesians 4:32. Yes, you did it. I trust that you did it. Stay standing up and stay right there. Next week is the beginning of a new month. And so on the 29th of May, that means at 5:30, your Pioneer Club is going to meet online. And Miss Rochelle is going to go over next month's verse for you. It's a wonderful verse. And it speaks to something that we're going to continue to do for the rest of the year. So tune in 5:30, and Miss Rochelle is going to teach you next month's verse. I hope that you will learn it. I hope that you will continue to study it when we're not together on this medium, and so that we can say it together and hide God's word in our heart together. I'm so looking forward to it. Now, since you're still standing, put your hands close, point them to the TV. Yes, this feels good for Pastor Mark. So let us pray together. Lord, thank you so much for our children. Thank you for the blessing and the joy that they are to us as a community. Thank you, Lord, that you give them the ability and the love in their hearts to recite your word and to hide it in their hearts. May they continue to do that all the days of their lives. Fill their hearts with good things this day, Lord, and may these hearts be tender toward you and tender toward others. In Jesus' name, amen. I cannot wait to do this again next week. Bye-bye. A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 20, verses 19 through 23. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with doors locked for fear of the Jewish leaders, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, their sins have been forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they have been retained." The word of the Lord.
Well, good morning, church. It is an absolute joy to be here. Greetings as well to those of you who happen to stumble upon us while going through YouTube. It is our joy to have you here as well. Honestly, if you're ever in the Tampa Bay area on a Sunday morning, come by and visit us. We would really love to see you and meet you. So, as you probably know, a couple of weeks ago was Easter Sunday, and for much of the world, that celebration just came and went. But for the ancient church, that celebration, that resurrection that Mark spoke of so beautifully, was never simply a one-day event, but instead, the ancient church celebrated the resurrection of Jesus Christ for a full 50 days, from Easter Sunday to Pentecost Sunday. And for years, we've been doing the same thing here at Tampa Covenant Church, even now, even during this particular season. So today, we're looking at a passage of Scripture that's part of this broader story. It comes from the later part of the 20th chapter of John's Gospel. I want to share a few things about it. Mark already read our text, so let's just begin by looking to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this day, for your glory, and for your grace. We do declare that you are pure and holy, and we thank you for the continued power of your Son's resurrection. So grant us this day your Spirit of glory and your brightness of presence, so that we might, by your grace and by your power, continue in the work that you've given us and to live out the word that we read this day. Amen. I don't know about you, but one of the downsides of living in this stay-at-home season that we're a part of is that, honestly, I have lost all track of time. I think back and Christmas feels like it was a year ago. St. Patrick's Day feels like it was 6 months ago. April, as best as I could tell, either began just yesterday or it's been going on forever. I mean, there are times where I'll think back on an event that took place, and I'm not sure if it took place yesterday or the day before or the day before that, only to later realize that it happened that very morning, that very same day, the craziness of that. I mean, everything is mixed up. Everything is a whirlwind. And sometimes I feel the same way when I read the gospel accounts of that very, very first Easter Sunday. I tend to forget that the women discovering the stone rolled away and Peter and John racing to the empty tomb and Mary Magdalene mistaking Jesus for a gardener and the two guys encountering Christ on the road to Emmaus and the meal that they have with him, and then how Jesus disappears and how they run back to Jerusalem. And the event that Mark read just a moment ago all occurred on the very same day, on the exact same day. This day that is packed with stuff. This day where all the events are both conflated and spread out over a long period of time, and it happens all at once. So we read that this very first Easter evening finds the disciples all together in a house, all together in a room, and they're huddled together, and they're trying to make sense of all that had taken place. They're swapping stories, they're comparing notes, and it's interesting that they're in a room with a door that is locked, saying something about the human condition. And it's locked. Why is it locked? It's locked because of the fear of the Jewish leaders.
But then while all this is taking place, Jesus suddenly comes into the room. He's in the room and he appears out of nowhere. And you wonder, did he walk through the wall? Did he appear in a puff of smoke? Did he shrink really, really small and go under the door and then grow up in front of them, which I think would be really cool? Is that how it happened? We don't really know. All we know is that first he isn't there, and then suddenly he is there, and it's a mystery. But he then speaks, and he says, "Peace be with you." And it's obvious that these words really don't resonate with these disciples that are there in that room, because Luke's gospel tells us that these disciples are freaking out. Luke writes that these disciples are startled and frightened. They fear that they've seen a ghost. But what does Jesus do? I love this. Jesus meets them where they're at. He does the exact same thing with you and me. He meets us where we're at. And he reassures them, and he shows them his hands, and he shows them his side. And it's like he's saying, "Don't worry. It's okay. It's really me." And verse 21 of John's gospel tells us that the disciples at this point are suddenly filled with joy. And for the second time, what does Jesus say? Jesus says, "Peace be with you." Now, the word peace that Jesus uses is not the English word peace. You probably figured that out already. Instead, it's the Hebrew word. It's the Aramaic word shalom. And this word shalom, while very similar to our English word peace, is at the same time a little different. It carries a bigger footprint. It takes up more real estate. Like our word peace, shalom is connected to the idea of tranquility and contentment. But it's also connected to justice and to health. It's connected to flourishing and to soundness. And especially, most of all, it is connected to the idea of wholeness, and in particular, spiritual and relational wholeness. Where there was once division, now there is unity that takes place. It's the idea of reconciliation that we read of in the pages of Scripture. Especially reconciliation in the one relationship that is most broken and most damaged, and that is our relationship with God. Yet Scripture tells us there is a remedy for this brokenness of relationship, and it is a relationship that is made right, not by anything we're able to do, but instead by the work of Jesus Christ. That this Jesus who did, in fact, do what we could not do on our own. This Jesus who kisses our disfigurement and takes upon himself our sin. This Jesus who grants us the peace that is most important and the peace that endures forever. And yet here he is, and he's declaring this word of peace, and he's declaring it not to a bunch of heroic people, but rather he's declaring this peace to a group of people who, when facing danger, withdrew from him and abandoned him. And in the case of Peter, even betrayed him. And yet here is this Jesus saying to these disciples, "Peace be with you." And if we are called by his name, he says the same to us. More than anything, this is the peace we need. This is the shalom. This is the reconciliation with God that we need. And yet from this particular kind of shalom comes the rest of shalom, especially this idea of contentment and tranquility, this notion of peace, especially when we face difficulties, especially at a time like this, this period of uncertainty where Jesus is still speaking this word, "Peace be with you." It's what Bethany read earlier from Psalm 29. This Lord who sits enthroned over the flood, who gives strength to those he created. This Lord who blesses his people, and he blesses them with peace. And again, it's the peace we need, especially at such a time as this. A peace that passes all understanding, even when things around us are, in fact, very, very hard to understand. But this kind of peace, this peace that I'm speaking of, is never something we could just keep to ourselves. Rather, it is a story that needs to be shared. So after extending this peace, what does Jesus say? Jesus says, as the Father has sent me, so I am sending you. I'm sending you out of this place where you're hiding. Let's unlock the door and let's go outside. 40 times in the Gospel of John, Jesus declares that he has been sent by the Father. But here in this moment that is just about at the very last chapter of John's Gospel, he says, not only has the Father sent me, but I'm now sending you. It's this call to mission, this call to mission that he speaks to his disciples, and through them, a call to mission that he speaks to us as well. It's what Mark and I have been discussing since the first of the year from the pulpit, how Jesus' signs and works and words connect not only to Christ's mission, but they also connect to our mission, our call. So what does Jesus do in preparation for this mission? He does two things. He breathes upon these disciples and he says, receive the Holy Spirit. And he also underscores this commission to go forth and to speak forth the gospel and to speak forth in particular the promise of the forgiveness of sins. And both of these things, the breathing and the commission, serve as foreshadows. They serve almost as down payments for what will actually take place 50 days later on the day of Pentecost. Jesus, in effect, is saying, taste and see what resurrection life is going to be like. Taste and see what gospel mission will consist of. So he says that to them, and he says that to us as well. But then we think about our lives, and we think about this present cultural moment we're in, and we have to wonder, well, how does this work at such a time as this? How does this work in a season of quarantine and in a season of social distancing and self-imposed isolation and shelter in place and stay-at-home orders and all this other kind of stuff? And, you know, it's easy to think that this doesn't connect, that perhaps we should just sit on our hands and perhaps we should just wait, and we should wait until the doors are open and we're given the green light to go outside and to actually be closer than 6 feet from other people. But then we look at Scripture and we look at the life, particularly the life of the Apostle Paul, and we realize that gospel ministry transcends even geography. We look at the Apostle Paul and we notice that arguably some of his most effective times of ministry took place not while he was with his ministry team going from Asia Minor to Macedonia to Achaia, but instead while he was sitting under house arrest. We notice that many of his most marvelous epistles were written not while he was walking the busy streets of Athens and Thessalonica and Corinth, but instead while he was chained to a Roman guard. So though Paul was limited, though Paul was confined, the gospel prevailed. And Paul is not alone. In the late second and third centuries, during a time of great persecution and pestilence, the gospel prevailed as believers cared not only for those that were part of the church, but also for those that were outside of the church. And they did so in the name of God, in the name of Jesus Christ. In 1521, while hiding in the Wartburg Castle, the gospel prevailed as Martin Luther used his solitude to translate the New Testament from the original Greek into German. And in doing so, his labors brought forth the gospel, brought forth the Bible to the German people in the vernacular, in their own language. In the early 1660s, while in a jail for preaching the good news of Christ's resurrection, the gospel prevailed as a man named John Bunyan penned several books, multiple gospel tracts, and an early draft of a book that would later be named The Pilgrim's Progress. In the late 19th century, though blind almost from birth, the gospel prevailed as a woman named Fanny Crosby composed more than 8,000 hymns and gospel songs, several of which have stood the test of time and are sung even today. In the early 1940s, though in a nation in the midst of war, the gospel prevailed as C.S. Lewis penned a series of radio broadcasts for the people of England that later became the foundation for his classic, Mere Christianity. There is something about the proclamation of the message of the gospel that is remarkably resilient and supple, even in the face of limitations. In fact, there's a sense where the work of God almost thrives in the presence of limitations. Gideon brings forth an army of 32,000 soldiers to fight the Midianites. And God looks at those 32,000 soldiers and he tells Midian, look, let's just send most of them home. We could do this with just 300 people. The power of God comes forth. There's something about limitation and constraint that enlivens creativity and enlivens the power of God. And we see bits of this even now as we look around us, as we look at what's taking place during this moment that we're in, as we see both on the internet and in our neighborhoods and on sidewalks and in resurrection eggs and in all sorts of different forms and in even YouTube videos, the gospel being communicated in some circles in ways that never would have been imagined even a year ago. And we see this especially in the area of prayer. We sometimes take prayer for granted, but we really shouldn't. Some 100 years ago, Samuel Zwemer wrote that the history of mission is the history of answered prayer. The groundwork for revival is not boots on the ground, but instead knees on the ground as individuals seek the Lord in intercession and in petition. And the beauty of intercession and petition and prayer is that it doesn't need a stadium and it doesn't need an arena. Instead, it can happen anywhere. It can happen even in your own house, even in a place of isolation, even in a place of quarantine, which I guess means that we should not waste this moment that we're in. But instead, we should seek our Lord in mission for the furtherance of this gospel. And what is the gospel? The gospel is the good news that we are ridiculously hopeless and inept when we try to fix ourselves. But that there is instead someone who can fix us. Someone who lived the life that we could never live on our own and someone who paid the price we could never pay on our own. Someone who rolled away the stone and walked through the empty tomb. Someone who sought out the disciples and commissioned them for service. And by the power and grace of the Holy Spirit, commissions you and me as well. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray that you would give us this day a vision of the work of your Son's resurrection and the power of your Spirit, so that by the power of your Spirit and the truth of the gospel, we may live lives of mission and of service and of prayer. Amen.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world.
In Psalm 145, King David exclaims, "I will extol you, my God and King, and I will bless your name forever." And so, church, magnify the Lord with me this morning, and let us extol and exalt his name together in prayer. Lord, it is right, and it is our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise. You are a God of majesty and splendor. By your power, you created all that is, making a universe out of nothing and ruling over all things in love. Throughout the ages, you called your people to love and serve you and to be your light among the nations. Lord, we praise you that in the fullness of time, you revealed your love to us by sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to be the light of the world. And so, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Hallelujah, glory be to our great God. Hallelujah, glory be to our great God.
We pray for those who suffer from illnesses of body and mind, those who are anxiously waiting test results, and those who are recovering from treatments and surgeries. We pray for those nearing the end of life's journey, and we pray for those who are walking with their loved ones on these difficult paths. Lord, we pray for those who grieve and mourn, and we give thanks for the lives of those they loved. We rejoice for the gift of new life, and pray for the protection of our unborn in this season of unpredictability. And so, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Hallelujah, glory be to our great God. Hallelujah.
Lord, your glory still shines brightly throughout the world. We commend our nation and all nations to your merciful care, that we may live securely in peace and in providence. Give all in authority the wisdom and strength to know your will and to do your will. And help all leaders to remember their calling to serve the people as lovers of justice and truth through Jesus Christ, our Lord. And so, Lord, in your mercy, please hear our prayer.
Hallelujah, glory be to our great God. Hallelujah.
We pray for the mission of our church, that in faithful witness we will preach the gospel to the ends of the earth. Lord, enable us to support the weak, provide comfort to the afflicted, companionship to the lonely, encouragement to the tempted, and hope for the disappointed. Lord, strengthen our marriages, protect our children, and watch over the aged. We continue to pray for the first responders in this church and throughout the world, the essential workers, and those that have need of work, and those who have been furloughed. And Lord, we ask that you would provide for their every need. So Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Hallelujah. Glory be to our great God. Hallelujah. Glory be to our great God.
Great and loving God, We thank you for the peace which the world cannot give. We ask you to calm our troubled hearts and dispel every fear. Keep us in your steadfast love and faithful to your word, that we may remain your dwelling place. And grant this through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives with you now and always in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. And so, Lord, we ask that you would hear us now as we join our voices together and pray the prayer that you taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The heavens are roaring.
Yes, indeed. What a beautiful name it is, the name of Jesus, the name that knits our hearts together in community. And so before we depart, just a few things that we want to share by way of encouragement. The first thing is this: stay connected. Stay connected to one another. And one of the ways that you can do this is by going to the website right there on that homepage. Scroll down to the bottom of that website and you'll see that there are four groups that are active, home groups that are active right now. Click, find out more about that home group and join them. They'll be delighted to have you. If you don't know what home group you would like to be a part of, need to find out a little bit more, Pastor Lou would be happy to help you with that. And also, if you are interested in starting a small group, please reach out to Pastor Lou as well. He will be delighted to hear from you, and he'll be able to assist you with that as well. The next thing is just care for one another. And we can care for one another by getting involved in each other's lives and assisting with physical needs. If you'd like to be a part of a list that we have growing, that you would like to be a part of that, please give a call to the office and we'll be happy to put your name on that list and give you a call when that need arises. Another way that you can care is to pray for one another. Please continue to click that link and send us your prayer request. If you have taken the time to fill out that link, we will take the time to give you a call and pray with you as well. And finally, communicate, meaning reach out to one another. Do it by way of card, email, text, the Zoom app, or any of those other meeting apps. Reach out to one another and just talk, communicate, and also send a letter. It's been really, really good to receive letters these last few weeks. And so thank you all for sending letters to us. And finally, thank you all so much, church, for your over-the-top generosity to us, to your church family. Thank you for the resources that you have provided for us. We do not know what the future holds, but we do know that God has been faithful to us thus far through your faithfulness to him in the giving of tithes and offerings. Therefore, we still declare he is our rock and he is our refuge, and in him we will continue to trust as we strive together for the furtherance of the gospel and the building of God's kingdom. Until we meet again and see one another again virtually, have a good and have a godly week, and may God bless you.
And brothers and sisters, as we close in worship, would you lift your hands to receive a blessing? May the Spirit of God cover you, protect you, and bless you with peace and contentment. As you live as agents of the gospel of forgiveness here and now and in this world, peace be with you. Amen. And as we go from here, let us recite the mystery of our faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And go now with God's peace, love, and serve the Lord. Amen.